This is side number 12 of Tumultuous Times, continuing on page number 249. Your reader's Fred Dawson. A consistent teaching of the church. The vast majority of Catholics favor not only the idea of a council, but also the doctrine of papal infallibility, the dogmatic definition of which, as was well known, would crown the labors of that august assembly. Nor was Pius IX mistaken when he wrote, quote, "It is claimed that the Church seeks to introduce a new dogma. No, there is a question only of affirming a truth known and acknowledged by universal Catholic tradition," unquote. That was quite true. The theological proposition states that the Pope, as the trustee of the Holy Spirit, enjoys personal infallibility and has no need of the Church's express concurrence when, as shepherd and teacher, he proclaims an article of faith. The Jesuits had asked for its inclusion among the canons of Trent. Bellarmine had spent his life defending it, and although questioned during the Jansenist and Galician disputes, it has been admitted without dispute by the great mass of Catholics since the beginning of the 18th century. The mendicants, the Jesuits, and the Redemptorists, together with Joseph de Maistre's Du Pape, had done much to secure its recognition. One may therefore say that the most fathers of the council already accepted the doctrine long before they assembled at the Vatican. The discussion of papal infallibility. When Pope Pius IX first proposed the convocation of a general council, two cardinals brought up the topic of papal infallibility. Although the primacy of the Pope had been listed as a topic of discussion, papal infallibility was not included on the original schema. Providently, the matter would be formally settled days before the forced ending of the council. Archbishop Manning of Westminster, Bishop Martin of Paderborn, Bishop von Senestri of Ratisbon, and Bishop Spalding of Baltimore and 500 other bishops deemed it opportune for the council to formally define papal infallibility. Numerous world leaders and a minority of bishops strongly opposed such a definition. There were various opinions as to whether or not it would be expedient to define papal infallibility at the time, so the controversy continued. Archbishop Manning approached the Pope regarding the matter on April the 19th, at a time when the Council was discussing various doctrinal issues. 10 days later, the Council Fathers were informed that papal infallibility would take precedent over other topics. The Vatican Council found it necessary to address the definition of papal infallibility, since this revealed truth had not been obscured in the past and was at that time denied by an increasing number of people. Papal infallibility had long been a stumbling block for heretics, liberals, and Galicians who were bold enough to deny or misrepresent it. Others opposed the formal definition in order to prevent further persecution of the Church. 7 months, however, was a long enough time for the Council to tackle the most controversial and most widely discussed item of all, namely the nature of the infallibility of the Pope. I've deliberately said the nature of the infallibility of the Pope and not whether the Pope was infallible, because it is quite erroneous to suppose that there was violent controversy within the Church as to whether or not the Pope, in certain special circumstances, spoke infallibly or not. Everybody within the Church was agreed that the Church was infallible in her dogmatic teaching on faith and morals. Everybody was agreed that the supreme authority within the Church was the Pope. It therefore followed that when the Pope defined dogma in the sphere of faith and morals, he would be safeguarded from error by the promise of the truth given by Christ to the Church. Discussion commences. The Fathers began formal discussions on papal infallibility on May the 13th and continued until June 3rd. The primacy of the Pope was discussed from June 6th until June 13th. The final detailed discussion regarding the wording of the decree on papal infallibility took place between June 15th and July 4th. The topic was debated by 57 speakers, 35 pro and 22 con. These speeches examine papal infallibility in the light of Scripture, apostolic tradition, and the general councils and history of the Catholic Church. The actions of Pope Liberius, 352 to 366 A.D., and Honorius I, 625 to 638 A.D., were debated at length, as well as other events that posed apparent contradictions. For additional information regarding Popes Liberius and Honorius I, refer to chapters 2 and 6. The case of Pope Liberius. Pope Liberius reigned during the height of the Arian heresy and was exiled by order of Emperor Constantinus for his opposition to it. Some authors claim that the Pope signed a document promoting Arianism. Brothers or Friars Rumble and Carty have refuted this false claim by asserting, historical research has shown that it is doubtful whether he signed the document at all. St. Athanasius and St. Hilary, who thought he did sign, insist that no charge of heresy could be made against Liberius on the score that the document was not necessarily heretical. On his return from exile, he defended the Nicene decisions against Arianism and remained a most uncompromising defender of the Orthodox doctrine until his death in 366 A.D. Ballerini says that if Liberius compromised the faith, which is by no means certain, it was not the result of full free will, for the fear of the Emperor Constantius was the motive, and still less in this fall was a definition of the faith involved. Many authors, like Socrates, Theodoret, and Scopius Severus, testify in favor of Liberius. Of the testimonies brought against him, several are evidently spurious, and even if they were genuine, they would show only a semi-Arian Catholicizing formula, but not an Arian creed. Hageman, in the Journal of Theological Literature, notes, Liberius can be accused, not of what he did, but what he omitted to do. He can, from a moral point of view, be blamed for his silence, for his weakness, while the dogmatic purity of his faith remains intact. The case of Pope Honorius I. Council witnessed many heated debates concerning papal infallibility. Opponents to papal infallibility fabricated every objection possible in order to prevent or defer its definition, even claiming that Honorius I was a heretical pope. Cardinal Manning refuted their false allegations. In the judgment of a cloud of the greatest theologians of all countries, schools, and languages, since the controversy was opened 200 years ago, the case of Honorius has been completely solved. Nay, more, it has been used with abundant evidence, drawn from the very same acts and documents, to prove that direct contrary hypothesis, namely, the infallibility of the Roman pontiffs. They who have cleared Honorius of personal heresy are an overwhelming majority with their opponents. It is vain for the antagonists of papal infallibility to quote this case as if it were certain. Centuries of controversy have established beyond contradiction that the accusation against Honorius that cannot be raised by the most ardent antagonist that more than a probability. And this probability at its maximum is less than abundant of his defense. I would therefore affirm the question of to be doubtful, which is of evidence for sufficient against the private judgment of his accusers. The cumulus of evidence for the infallibility of Roman pontiff overweighs all such doubts. The following points in the case of Honorius can be abundantly proven from documents. A, that Honorius defined no doctrine whatsoever. B, that he forbade the making of any new definition. C, that his fault was precisely in the omission of apostolic authority, for which he was justly censured. D, that his two epistles are entirely orthodox, though, in the use of the language, he wrote, as was usual before the condemnation of monotheism, and not as it became necessary afterwards. It is an anachronism and an injustice to censure his language used before that condemnation, as it might be just to censure it after the condemnation has been made. To this I add the following excellent passage from Pastoral of the Archbishop of Baltimore. Quote, "The case of Honorius forms no exception, for, first, Honorius expressly says in his letter to Sergius that he meant to define nothing, and he was condemned precisely because he temporized and would not define. Second, because in his letters he clearly taught the sound Catholic doctrine, only enjoining silence as to the use of certain terms that new in the Church, and third, because his letters were not addressed to a general council of the whole Church, and were rather private than public and official. At least they were not published, even in the East, until several years later. The first letter was written to Sergius in 633, and 8 years afterwards, in 641, to Emperor Heraclius, in exculpating himself to Pope John II, Honorius's successor, for having published his edict, the Ethesis, which enjoined silence on the disputants, namely, similar to that imposed by Honorius, lay the whole responsibility thereof on Sergius, who he declares composed the edict. Evidently, Sergius had not communicated the letter to the emperor, probably because of its contents. If published, would have suited his wily purpose of secretly introducing, under another form, the Eutychian heresy. Thus falls to the ground the only case upon which the opponents of infallibility have continued to insist. The entire subject has been exhausted by many recent learned writers." The discussion continues. "The Council Fathers were able to prove beyond all doubt the fact that not a single pope had ever erred in his office as universal pastor of the Church. Numerous popes caused scandal by their personal conduct, including John the 12th, Benedict the 9th, Urban the 6th, Innocent the 8th, Alexander the 6th, and Leo the 10th. Others, due to human frailty, had been weak and ineffective leaders. In spite of their shortcomings, God preserved them from all teaching doctrinal errors to his universal Church. After weeks of discussion, practically every facet of papal infallibility was covered from every conceivable angle. If it had been proven that any of the popes had ever formally promulgated heretical teachings on faith and morals, the secular newspapers of the time would have seized the opportunity to ridicule the Church and then crush the matter once and for all. This did not occur. For the past 300 years, various writers have attacked the dogma of papal infallibility by alluding to the examples of Popes Liberius, Vigilius, Honorius, and others. Manning stated these objections have already been answered. I should hardly have thought that any theologian or scholar would have brought up again the cases of Vigilius, Liberius, and John the 22nd, etc. But as these often refuted and senseless contentions have been renewed, I give in the footnote references to the works and places in which they are abundantly answered. Infallibility does not guarantee in any way the personal teachings or morals of a pope, but empowers him to protect the deposit of faith from all corruption." Friar Adolfi Tanqueray explains, "The pope must be speaking not as a private teacher, nor as bishop of the city of Rome, nor as a temporal prince, but as a shepherd and teacher of the whole Church in virtue of his supreme authority. He must be teaching a truth of faith or morals. He must define, in other words, finally settle what is to be held with really interior faith, and the definition must impose an obligation on the universal Church. Divine safeguard from error in matters of faith and morals. The popes have never erred in matters of faith and morals when addressing the universal Church and speaking officially as a teacher, with the intention of obligating its members to assent to their definitions. The fact that this council did indeed promulgate the doctrine of papal infallibility is proof that the Ultramontanists were able to masterfully refute every objection hurled against them by the Galicians. They were able to establish beyond all doubt the fact that, since the foundation of the Catholic Church, not a single pope, even those who caused scandal because of conduct or weakness, had ever erred in his office as pope while using the supreme apostolic authority when teaching the universal church in matters of faith or morals. Our Lord entrusted St. Peter and the apostles with a mission of imparting his teaching to all nations. Their mission was to continue until the end of the world, yet St. Peter and the apostles were mortal men, destined to pass away. Jesus Christ assured us that his guidance would continue with their successors until the end of time. Behold, I am with you all days, even unto the consummation of the world. Christ provided for the precise transmission of his immutable teachings from age to age by means of papal infallibility, a teaching authority that is divinely safeguarded from error in matters of faith and morals. The popes possess the same infallible teaching authority that was conferred on St. Peter, the first pope. The pope can invent no new doctrines nor teach anything contrary to the deposit of faith, even if he claims divine inspiration. This is explained by Cardinal Gibbons. What, then, is the real doctrine of infallibility? It simply means that the pope, as successor of St. Peter, by virtue of the promises of Christ, is preserved from error of judgment when he promulgates to the church a decision of faith or morals. The pope, therefore, be it known, is not the maker of divine law. He is only its expounder. He is not the author of revelation, but only its interpreter. All revelation came from God alone through his inspired ministers and was complete in the beginning of the church. The Holy Father has no more authority than you or I to break one iota or tittle of the scripture, and he is equally with us, a servant of the divine law. Archbishop Deschamps. The two great ecclesiastics championed the cause of papal infallibility, which was the majority opinion of the Council Fathers. One was the Primate of Belgium, Archbishop Deschamps of Mechelen or Malines, and the other Archbishop Manning of Westminster, England. Both later became cardinals. Archbishop Victor Deschamps, a Redemptorist, was a proficient writer. His writings fill 14 volumes. He was a highly trained theologian, and his speeches and pamphlets during the council were among the very best. It is probably true to say that no other bishop had so great a hand in the actual formulation of the two great dogmatic constitutions of the council. He was a man of great charm and attractive personality, and while uncompromising in urging his views, he was all friendly and conciliatory to opponents. Archbishop Manning. Archbishop Henry Manning of Westminster, a convert from Anglicanism, saw the definition of papal infallibility as a means of drawing converts to the Catholic faith. He reasoned that the assurance of divine guidance and infallibility in matters of faith and morals when the Pope addressed the Universal Church would be a means of drawing lost sheep back to Christ. Manning worked tirelessly to bring about a definition of papal infallibility and gave his inspiring speech to the council on May the 25th, 1870. The next is Bishop Gasser. Prince Bishop Vincent Gasser of Brixen, Austrian Tyrol, gave a speech to the council fathers that lasted nearly 4 hours. He spoke of three main points of contention: the pope's personal, separate, and absolute infallibility. In what sense is the pope's infallibility personal? It is personal in that it belongs to the Roman pontiff, not the Roman church or the Roman see. The infallibility is personal in as far as it belongs to each legitimate occupant of the Roman see. But it is not personal as belonging to the pope as private person or private doctor. So we do not speak of personal infallibility, although we attribute it to the person of the Roman pontiff, not as an individual person, but as a public person, the head of the church in his relation to the universal church. Nor is the Pope infallible simply as Pope, but as subject to the divine assistance guiding him. In what sense is the infallibility of the Pope to be called separate? It may be called separate, or rather distinct, because it is founded on the special promise of Christ and on the special assistance of the Holy Ghost, which is not the same as that enjoyed by the whole body of the teaching church joined with its head. In what sense is the Pope's infallibility absolute? In no sense is it absolute, because absolute infallibility belongs to God alone. The Pope is restricted by limitations and conditions that set forth in the definition. Opponents to the definition of papal infallibility. Because of the strong undercurrent caused by influential bishops, priests, laity, and government officials, a sense of suspicion and distrust pervaded the council until its final session. Many prelates who opposed the formal definition of papal infallibility were Galicians, who believed that the authority of the Pope was subordinate to the general councils and consent of the Church. Bishop Marat of Sura, the dean of the Faculty of Theology at the Sorbonne, even wrote a book against papal infallibility that bordered on heresy. Lord Acton resided in Rome, gathering information about the council proceedings in order to mount an effective attack against papal infallibility. Dr. Dollinger was also a determined opponent of the formal definition of papal infallibility. In letters purported to be from Rome, Dollinger, writing under the pseudonym Quirinius, attacked the work of the council. Numerous pamphlets attacking the doctrine of papal infallibility were disseminated, and many of the news reports from the Vatican Council were intentionally falsified by the press. Professor Jürgen Ruther of Würzburg University wrote the book Anti-Janus to Counter Dillinger's Works. Like Dillinger, he too was professor of church history and held a leading position among Catholic scholars in Germany. But, unlike Dillinger, he knew how to combine thoroughly scientific investigation with due respect for the divinely constituted authority of the church. Archbishop Friedrich Schwarzenberg of Prague and Archbishop Joseph Rauscher of Vienna were leaders of the minority and voiced their opposition to the formal declaration of papal infallibility. They were not Catholic dissidents, but rather stalwart defenders of Catholic faith in Austria, especially after the revolutionary movements of 1848. The great revival of Catholicism throughout the Austrian Empire was largely due to the zeal of these two prince archbishops. The two prelates, especially Rauscher, had also been primary negotiators of the Concordat of 1855 between the Holy See and the Austrian government. Their opposition to the formal definition proposed by the council was not indicative of any unorthodoxy on their part. They opposed the timeliness of the pronouncement because they feared it would result in a wide-scale persecution of the church. Some prelates claim that the definition of papal infallibility would be an obstacle toward unity with Protestant and Orthodox churches. A number of influential ecclesiastics, among them Bishop Duan Loup of Orleans, Bishop Darboy of Paris, Bishop Strossmayer of Sermio, Archbishop Purcell of Cincinnati, Archbishop Kenrick of St. Louis, Bishop von Kettler of Mainz, and Bishop Helpful of Rotterdam, did all in their power to prevent the formal definition of papal infallibility. Once, however, the dogma was solemnly proclaimed, they obediently assented and bade their clergy to follow their example. According to the eyewitness account of Archbishop Manning, a certain number were found of the opinion that it was inopportune to define the infallibility of the Roman pontiff. This was a question of prudence, policy, expedience, not of doctrine nor of truth. It was thus that the church was united 20 years ago, 1854, in the belief of the Immaculate Conception, while some were still to be found who doubted the prudence of defining it. Setting aside this one question of opportuneness, there was not in the Council of the Vatican a difference of any gravity, and certainly no difference whatsoever on any doctrine of the faith. I've never been able to hear of five bishops who denied the doctrine of papal infallibility. Bishop Dupont-Loup of Orleans. We've already heard of the valor of Bishop Felix Dupont-Loup of Orleans in wielding his pen to defend the syllabus of errors. Nevertheless, he strongly opposed the formal definition of papal infallibility. Throughout February and March, many bishops engaged in heated debates concerning this topic, voicing their opinions for or against the pronouncement. Bishop Dupont-Loup, however, surpassed the others in the intensity of his activities. He had six secretaries working to help propagate his message against the proclamation of infallibility, and he circulated numerous letters and pamphlets promoting his opinions throughout Europe, especially in Paris and Munich. Ironically, another of his writings, his doctoral dissertation, had been published many years earlier to defend the infallibility of the Roman pontiff. His opposition to the proposed definition at the council did not indicate a renouncement of his belief in papal infallibility. Rather, he merely believed that the time was inopportune for a universal proclamation. The need for papal infallibility. There is an absolute need for God's protection over the Church in matters of faith and morals in order to assure the precise transmission of truth from age to age. The Church, guided by God, has always taught what it is teaching today. It cannot change its teaching. It gives the same teaching in every nation and every century of history. In 1951, Friar Martin Scott, S.J., expounded this topic in his work entitled Reasonableness of Infallibility. No church can be the Church of Christ which does not profess to be an infallible representative of the infallible founder of Christianity. Christ did not establish Christianity in order to have it either perish or mislead. Christ, in establishing his church, endowed her with an infallible voice which should define the truths of revelation with divine certainty when occasion should require it. This infallible voice does not proclaim a new revelation, but only states definitely what has been divinely revealed. In so divining revelation, the Pope is not inspired, as were the prophets of old, nor does he announce new doctrines, but simply declares the true sense of the revelation which has been made once for all. In doing this, he has the guarantee of Jesus Christ that he will be assisted from on high, so that what he defines will be what God intended by the revelation in question, when it was given to mankind. Father Joseph Fenton explains that the teachings of Christ have been preserved through the ages in various matters. A. Not all of the doctrine entrusted to the Church, as the content of divine public revelation was immediately, at the very outset of the Church's life, set down in writing by the fathers of the Church. B. Not all of the ancient monuments of divine apostolic tradition, the writings and inscriptions of early Christians, have survived until our time, even though the tradition itself has survived and is just as perfectly possessed, guarded, and taught by the infallible Church today as it was in apostolic times. C. Although the whole content of divine public revelation has always been guarded and presented infallibly by the Church, it has not always been, in its entirety, distinctly conceived and formally expressed. D. A doctrine proposed as part of the divine apostolic tradition by the true Church of Jesus Christ at any one period in its history cannot possibly be in opposition to what has been taught as divinely revealed by the Church at an earlier time. And E. A doctrine proposed at any time within the true Church of God as part of divine public revelation must, by reason of the divine assistance promised and given to the Church, have been taught in the past, at least in an implicit manner, by the majority of the ecclesia docens. Moreover, such a teaching could never be denied by a majority of the authentic teachers within the Church. yet they were denied by Vatican II. Voting. The Council hoped to produce a text of strict theological accuracy, neither supporting nor condemning any of the factions battling over papal infallibility. The subject of the definition was not the controversial ideas of the moment, but the traditional belief of the Church, the belief set out by such classic teachers as Bellarmine and St. Thomas. The opposition, headed by Duan Loop, was for the most part unwillingly openly to vote against the Pope, and at the end of June, before the final vote, Duan Loop and most of his supporters withdrew from Rome to their diocese on the excuse that the approach of the war between France and Germany required that they stand by their flocks. On July the 13th, at the 85th session of the Council, a final vote could be taken to decide whether papal infallibility would now be formally defined. Of 601 bishops present, 451 voted in favor of the definition, 88 voted against it, and 62, suggesting certain corrections to be made, gave their conditional assent. There was some consternation over the fact that one-fourth of the bishops, including many noteworthy prelates, failed to give their full assent. However, it was apparent that the definition would be forthcoming. Many who had voted their dissent opted to leave Rome quietly before the formal promulgation, so they would not be obliged to publicly oppose the decree. However, they declared beforehand their submission to the Council's decision if the Pope seemed to promulgate this doctrine. The Franco-Russian War began on July the 19th, 1870. The decree on papal infallibility, Pastor Eternus. The decree that formally defined papal infallibility also addressed the various aspects of papal primacy, its institution, nature, power, and infallibility. The Roman pontiffs, on their part, according as the condition of the times and circumstances dictated, sometimes calling together ecumenical councils or sounding out the mind of the Church throughout the whole world, sometimes through regional councils or sometimes using other helps which divine providence supplied, have, with the help of God, defined as to be held such matters as they found consonant with the Holy Scriptures and with the apostolic tradition. The reason for this is that the Holy Spirit was promised to the successors of St. Peter, not that they might make known new doctrine by his revelation, but rather that with his assistance they might religiously guard and faithfully explain the revelation or deposit of faith that was handed down through the apostle. Indeed, it was this apostolic doctrine that all the fathers held and the holy orthodox doctrines reverenced and followed. For they fully realized that this See of St. Peter always remains untainted by any error, according to the divine promise of our Lord and Savior made to the Prince of his disciples. I have prayed for thee that thy faith may not fail, and do thou, when once thou hast turned again, strengthen thy brethren. Luke 22:32. Now, this charism of truth, never failing faith was conferred upon St. Peter and his successors in this chair, in order that they might perform their supreme office for the salvation of all, that by them the whole flock of Christ might be kept away from the poison of error and be nourished by the food of heavenly doctrine, that with the occasion of schism removed, the whole church might be preserved as one and secure on its foundation, stand firm against the gates of hell. And so, faithfully keeping to the tradition received from the beginning of the Christian faith, for the glory of God our Savior, for the exaltation of the Catholic religion, and for the salvation of Christian peoples, we, with the approval of the Sacred Council, teach and define that it is a divinely revealed dogma that the Roman Pontiff, when he speaks ex cathedra, that is, one, when acting in the office of shepherd and teacher of all Christians, 2, defines, and 3, by virtue of his supreme apostolic authority, 4, doctrine concerning faith or morals, 5, to be held by the universal church, possesses through the divine assistance promised to him in the person of St. Peter the infallibility with which the divine Redeemer willed his church to be endowed in defining doctrine concerning faith or morals, and that such definitions of the Roman pontiff are therefore irreformable because of their nature, but not because of the agreement of the church. The Vatican Council's decree on papal infallibility included a section from Pope Eugene IV's papal bull, Latenter Kylie, of the Council of Florence, that the Apostolic See and the Roman Pontiff hold primacy over the whole world, and that the Pontiff of Rome himself is the successor of the Blessed Peter, the chief of the apostles, and is the true vicar of Christ and head of the whole church and faith, and teacher of all Christians, and that to him was handed down his blessing in Blessed Peter by our Lord Jesus Christ, full power to feed, rule, and guide the universal church, just as is also contained in the records of the ecumenical councils and the sacred canons. Cardinal John Henry Newman and the majority of the church fathers were very pleased with the final wording of the dogma of papal infallibility. On July the 27th, 1870, Newman wrote, "For myself, ever since I was a Catholic, I have held the Pope's infallibility as a matter of theological opinion. At least I see nothing in the definition which necessarily contradicts scripture, tradition, or history." Ex cathedra. In his book, The Vatican Council and Its Definitions, Pastoral Letter to the Clergy, Cardinal Manning explains the term ex cathedra and its historical significance. The definition limits the infallibility of the pontiff to the acts which emanate from him ex cathedra. This phrase, which has been long and commonly used by theologians, has now, for the first time, been adopted into the terminology of the Church, and in adopting it, the Vatican Council fixes its meaning. The pontiff speaks ex cathedra when, and only when, he speaks as the pastor and doctor or teacher of all Christians. By this, all acts of the pontiff are as a private person or a private doctor or as a local bishop or as a sovereign of a state are excluded. In all these acts, the pontiff may be subject to error. In one and one only capacity, he is exempt from error, that is, when as teacher of the whole church in things of faith and morals. When a pope speaks ex cathedra, he simply makes a public declaration of which has always been the teaching of the church. And since the church is where Peter is, and since Peter speaks through the Roman pontiff and through his successors, continues to live and exercise judgment and offer the truth of faith to those who seek it. Therefore, divine revelation must be accepted in that sense alone in which it is and has been held by the Roman chair of the Blessed Peter, which is the mother and teacher of all churches, and has ever kept the faith given by Christ the Lord whole and inviolate, and has taught it to the faithful, showing to all the path of salvation and the doctrine of incorrupt truth. Father Joseph Fenton concisely defines the term ex cathedra in his article in the American Ecclesiastical Review entitled Infallibility in the Encyclicals. According to the teaching of the Vatican Council itself, the Holy Father speaks infallibly when he issues a definition ex cathedra, and he issues a definition ex cathedra when the following conditions are verified. 1. He speaks in his capacity as the ruler and teacher of all Christians. 2. He uses his supreme apostolic authority. 3. The doctrine on which he is speaking has to do with faith and morals. 4. He issues a certain and definitive judgment on that teaching. 5. He wills that this definitive judgment be accepted as such by the universal church. In recent years, there have been some misunderstandings concerning the term ex cathedra. Literally taken, this term means from the chair. Therefore, some would say the pope must actually be seated in his chair in order to fulfill the requirements for speaking infallibly. This is erroneous. As the following explanation illustrates, ex cathedra refers to the characteristics that must accompany an infallible proclamation. The quality and condition of the act of infallible definition is that the pope speaks ex cathedra, This term is received in the schools, and its meaning is defined as follows. When the Pope speaks not as a private doctor or as bishop of a diocese, but as exercising the office of supreme pastor, the teacher of all Christians. Moreover, not every way suffices of propounding a doctrine, even as supreme pastor and teacher, but there must be the intention of manifested, of definite defining as doctrine, or of putting an end to the controversy on some doctrine by giving a definitive sentence and propounding that doctrine is to be held by the universal church. And this property and note of definition in the strict sense, the Pope should at least in some measure express when he defines a doctrine to be held by the universal church. And this is the end of side number 12. It will be continued on side 13.